In this thing, but you can run notes a lot better when you have this. Which it does sound like a straight pick when it's running, but you get it down though. It's harder to get lost with that than it would be just a normal straight pick. Now, one of the old numbers, I think, that's been played on banjo. I know for at least 75 years, there's an old thing called Cumberland Gap. The chorus part of Cumberland Gap is a very hard piece of music to play. I don't know why. It's simple in one way and hard in another. I think it's so simple, it's hard. But I'd like to play just a little bit of it for kind of in a slow style and see if you can catch the tune out a little better. Most important things about a banjo is tuning it. I never have learned to do that yet. Accidentally, sometimes you get one in tune and it sounds a little better in tune to do it. Don't you agree, Carl? Yeah. Does anybody have any questions they'd like to ask? If you do, feel free to do so. Well, I've always found that by placing the little finger and this next to it along here, it gives you better position to get tone. But I would suggest that if this felt uncomfortable to anybody, that you fix your hand to where you've got the most comfortable position. Of course, the further back you go, I think sharpness, and then you can vary your tone up and down between here and here. But I honestly believe wherever your hand feels the best at is the best place to keep it, if it's comfortable. Well, I find if I get my hand in position to kind of get the thumb and the finger closer together, like this. In other words, you're propping. That's right, and it leaves your fingers free to move. And any time that your hand feels it's getting in a cramped position, there's something wrong somewhere. I mean, you're either exerting too much effort or you're putting yourself under too much strain to play. And as you banjo pickers know, the thumb cramp can kill you in about 2 minutes and a half if you ever get it. Feels like it's going to break off.
Why carry me back to old Virginia and bury you, your hand up?
Thank you. say cabin in Carolina. I mean, there's some notes you want predominating. Now, there's another trick to this trade I'll show you folks. It's a trick with your left hand. You do a lot of pulling with your left. In other words, it sounds like it's coming from the right hand, but actually a lot of it's coming from the left. Like that. And you build them fingers by working them. In other words, the more stouter your fingers are, the better.
In other words, you might have a string going that you didn't pick with your right hand.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You got several of them going you ain't picking with your right hand sometime.
You may have, but I don't know many others.
The reason I learned that was in case I lost my right hand, I might still be able to do just a little bit with the left hand. But you'll find, if you learn that trick, it helps quite a bit. Just say, for instance, in case you get laryngitis in your thumb, you resort to the other hand.
You can start the tone with your right hand, but you can emphasize it with your left hand.
That's right. You can scale it off of your left.
Hey, John
Henry. Hi, John Henry? That thing worked up one time.
Yes,
Several finger rolls that can be used on a banjo. There's one particular type that I used to follow a little more strongly than I do now, is timing with your left hand and keep your roll going steady all the time. Don't never change it.
How long did we work on this,
man? Huh?
How long did we work on this? I know Don worked on this for over 5 years before he could perfect it to suit me.
Well, it still ain't done it to suit me yet, but it can be done. Let's take Goodbye Lies of Jane. I'll play it for you using the stop style first, the weight, and then use the roll all the way through without changing. Studied about it and thought about it and contemplated with different people, and after 5 years I have come to one conclusion. I'm going to have to change the strings on this thing. I think one died and the rest has gone to the funeral on this one. Particular number here kind of started a different trend in banjo. I used to work with Arthur Guitar Boogie Smith, who in my estimation is a fine musician, wonderful entertainer. Arthur used to be a music teacher, And I mentioned Limehouse Blues to him. I used to play it on guitar, and I always liked the number. I said, I'd make a good five-string banjo number. No, he said, it's impossible to play that on a five-string banjo. And so I decided I'd learn it if it'd kill me. And I never said anything more to Arthur about Limehouse Blues till we'd done recorded it.
Don, now you talking about Arthur Smith, and I know you worked with him twice.
Yeah.
But let's go back to when you were a young boy and first heard the banjo and first got interested in it, and why.
Well, the first time I ever heard a banjo, I thought it was about one of the loudest things I ever heard in my life. I think it was because of the way the guy was playing it, more or less. And the head was all down on it, and he didn't know how to tune one proper, I don't think. Then I heard Snuffy Jenkins play a five-string banjo, and I knew that I'd heard something that I felt like the world should hear. Snuffy was a wonderful man. He's still in Columbia, South Carolina. He took me when I was a small boy and kind of took me under his wing, so to speak, like I've done a lot of the young banjo pickers that's come down the way. Snuffy learned me one thing that I'll never forget. He says, you can learn something from the sorriest picker that ever picked up an instrument. He says, he'll have something good. And he said, don't ever forget that. And I never have. Snuffy got a lot of kick out of showing me. In other words, starting me off, showing me how to set my banjo up and the picks. And a few things that he did. And I still think that he's one of the cleanest five-string banjo pickers I ever heard. I mean, was smooth as silk. He didn't play too many different numbers, but he could play Sally Gooden, and if it didn't make your hair stand up, you're bound to be bald-headed, I'll tell you. And, Sally Goodwin?
Yeah.
Now, there's a proper boy. We usually call it Sally Gooden, but it is Goodwin, ain't it? Questions from anybody? Follow the leader. Follow the leader. Question? Yeah. No, same role. Same role. Mm-hmm. All right, we'll... Other hand. What's that?
The
thumb and front finger.
That's
general rule. On to you that might help you. Think of anything, Carl, that you've been asked? When you and I were young, Maggie. Now there's a note, there's a chord for every note in a song. And it's good to learn the neck of your instrument, whatever instrument play, you find yourself finding it awful handy. And if you'll learn the chords, or pick the chords out to a number, it'll enlighten you on if you're needing a higher note than you've got here, come here, get it. Let's take, for instance, when you and I were young, Maggie, I'll try to show you the chord progression and lead. Just pick the lead.
Get to you in a minute, Dave. When Don did follow the leader, we were recording in Cincinnati, and we needed another song to finish out an album. And most of the time when Don Red recorded, we'd write the material either on the way to Cincinnati or when we got there. We never had anything before we got there. So we need another number, and Don says, okay, he goes in, picks up the banjo, and he plays this thing. And I don't know whether we've ever played it or he's ever played it since. There's several numbers he did that way. Banjo Riff was just made up in the spur of the moment.
And never have been able to play it since I recorded it. I really haven't. Recorded that number at 12 o'clock one night. Actually, we'd cut, 19 numbers. It was the 20th one. And Sid Nathan of King Records come in the studio and says, can you do something with a beep, beep, beep? I mean, that's all. That's the only note Sid could hit was that peep note. And I got the banjo down and recorded. I didn't even recognize it when it come out. In fact, the first time I ever heard it, I thought, well, somebody's copying me down to the T here or something. I'd better get busy.
We were in the car.
Yeah, this has been several years ago. I think about 1956, somewhere along there, 7. Somebody want to follow the leader? We'll see what we can do with
Thank you.
Let's take Dear Old Dixie, for instance. It's very simple played open keyed. Of course, y'all know how it goes. Snuffy Jenkins play that. I guess that's about one of the first numbers I ever heard him play when I was a little bitty shaver. Now you can transpose the thing to A flat. Let's see. And it's a little bit harder to do, but it can be done. I mean, this is a key that don't leave you too much space back to work. To move it to from here up the neck. I mean, you use the same position, the same chords that you would in A flat. B flat's the same thing. You just got to remember you're at the third fret back here as far as key is concerned. You want to move anything too like that. I always found when I used a capo, I cut myself off 2 frets, 3 frets, 4 frets back here and shortened the scope of my instrument. And a lot of times I want to run back into this part and work that. I mean, that's the only real criticism I'd have to a capo. I mean, anybody that uses them, fine. I always feel my job to MC a show as a general rule, and no kidding, by the time I got my capo fixed, I'd found I'd said several words I shouldn't have, you know? See you after a while. Thank you so much for being such a wonderful audience. Yes, Carlton. Thank you. When I was a kid, breakdown music was always a love that I had. I used to hound fiddle players, worrying about half to death, trying to learn the correct way to play the whole breakdown stuff. Benny and myself have discussed this many times. When we'd find a fiddle player that played, if about four or five of them played it the same way, we figured we had it right, didn't we, Ben?
Yeah, you find one, there's a difference in the licks, you know. There's an old-time Georgie Slim lick. And there's an Arthur Smith lick. You people that's interested in fiddle, a fiddle is the most tedious of all.
Thank you.
But you play smart right down the line. What do you love about heartache? You've always won every love about.